We are T-minus 3 weeks and counting from The Dark Knight Rises, and so we continue with this special Movies Are Weird retrospective on the quartet of Batman movies that started it all. As we discussed last week, there's no denying that Tim Burton's 1989 Batman was not only a groundbreaking movie, but also one of the most influential blockbusters ever. But looking back with fresh eyes, I also couldn't deny that it's an extremely uneven, disjointed, problematic film, and I'm not the only one. Batman may have catapulted Tim Burton to the top of Hollywood's directorial A-list, but he was very unhappy with how the movie turned out and was not planning to come back for a sequel. Warner Brothers, wanting to hang on to a director they thought had the golden touch for the Caped Crusader, ultimately wooed Burton back by promising him much greater creative control than he'd had on the first one, a decision that they would live to regret. The film was yet another extremely troubled production. A very public controversy erupted over who should be playing Catwoman before Michelle Pfeiffer landed the role, and while the earliest pitch of having her and the Penguin as the bad guys were there from the beginning, the original screenplay was extensively rewritten at Burton's insistence. Among the most interesting omissions, a young Marlon Wayans was initially cast as a drastically reimagined version of Robin, only to be written out of the screenplay shortly before production commenced. Incidentally, the more traditional Dick Grayson version of Robin had been similarly excised from the first movie. The result of all this, Batman Returns, is basically a much more extreme version of its predecessor. All the stuff that was good about the first movie, i.e. Burton's morbid aesthetic sensibility, Danny Elfman's trend-setting score, the fantastic industrial gothic set design, and the twisted comic book logistics of both the good and bad guys' increasingly elaborate schemes, are better than ever. The stuff that's bad is even worse. Danny DeVito's leering, monster pervert Penguin, while he basically has nothing whatsoever to do with the original comic version of the character, is a thing to behold. While his circus freak army and the reveal of their ultimate evil plan is some of the most awesomely nightmarish stuff anyone ever put in a big-budget blockbuster. And really, what else needs to be said about Pfeiffer's Catwoman at this point? One of the all-time great genre movie femme fatales, a character whose presence drop-kicked an entire generation of young men into early puberty, and probably told us everything we ever needed to know about Tim Burton's sexual psyche. It even probably still has the best action sequences of the original series, even if they still couldn't do anything about poor Michael Keaton not being able to move inside that god-awful rubber costume the movies still insist on covering Batman with to this very day. So yeah, all that audio, visual, mood piece stuff, that all still works. Everything else, on the other hand, is pretty much disastrous. The movie makes even less sense than the first one, and plays out like a series of barely connected episodes. The Penguin seems to go through about three or four separate master plans, while Christopher Walken's Max Schreck character, who was originally conceived as the Penguin's long-lost brother, hangs around with not a lot of discernible purpose. And while I kinda dig the fact that the second act's Penguin running for mayor B-story is actually an adaptation of a Penguin-centric episode from the old Adam West show, it's ultimately a pointless mid-film diversion. Once again, Batman gets pretty much nothing to do in the plot of his own movie other than react to whatever the bad guys do, and what initiative he does take doesn't really make a lot of sense. Why is Bruce Wayne hung up on Selina Kyle? Why is he the only person who mistrusts the Penguin right away? More glaringly, Returns is where it becomes unavoidably obvious that however talented and well-intentioned the filmmakers were, Burton and company really, really didn't get Batman. At all. Like, yeah, I like Danny DeVito as this nasty, evil version of the Elephant Man creature, but I'm sorry, a puppy is not a Volkswagen, a cheese wheel is not a pillow, and this isn't the Penguin. And yeah, I know Catwoman has had a lot of revised origin stories over the years, but what made her interesting for so long in the comics is that she's often one of the few Batman antagonists who's probably less crazy than Batman, a rare female villain who looks how she looks and does what she does because she just wants to. In Returns, all that woman in charge of her own sexual power ferocity gets explained as, oh, she went crazy, which is disappointing and seriously lame. And yes, I'm sorry, Batman just shouldn't be straight up murdering people, which is what he totally does to a bunch of Penguin's clown guys, and he really shouldn't be enjoying himself so much as he does it. There's not many things that you have to get right about Batman, but those are two of them. Batman Returns was ultimately a big hit for Warner Brothers, but it actually didn't do as well as they were projecting for it to do. Worse, while giving Burton creative freedom to make the film as dark and perverse as he did probably led to most of the stuff that works, the film became a public relations nightmare for the studio almost immediately upon its release. See, while the first Batman was the movie that made it okay for adults to love superhero flicks, unsurprisingly, a character that was initially conceived for children got most of its long-term merchandise staying power from children. So when parents carted truckloads of kids who'd worn out their VHS tapes of the first movie off to theaters for the sequel, largely unprepared for the sheer volume of violence, gore, barely concealed S&M fetishism between Batman and Catwoman, and Penguin's near-constant barrage of lecherous sexual innuendo, there was a major public backlash. Parents groups complained that such a dark movie had no business being merchandised with an eye on younger audiences. McDonald's had to all but publicly apologize for granting the film a Happy Meal tie-in. Kenner, who had the license to make Batman Returns action figures, didn't even bother trying to make a version of DeVito's Monster Penguin for the official toy line, going with a classic version instead. Warner Brothers was panicked by all of this. They had an entire long-term Batman merchandising empire in the works, including a high-profile animated series that was still in production at the time, and they were seriously concerned that Burton's increasingly dark approach would jeopardize those plans. And next week, I'll revisit the steps they took that changed the course of the series and the history of comic book movies
forever.
I'm Bob, and that's The Big Picture.